All right, welcome everybody. We're going to do a run through of the Camect Hub. Kind of start off on what the experience is when you log into it. We'll go through the different settings, explain the difference between our hub settings and our camera settings. A lot of times they look like you're in the same page, but they're a little bit different. And it's kind of a cool feature in the fact that you can set up sort of a global setting for how you want your cameras to act and the things that they're looking for, and then simply check one box and it'll apply to each camera that you check that box on. It saves down on saves on the setup time, so you don't have to go through and set up each camera with all those individual settings. We'll tell you how to be able to review alerts, be able to look at a timeline for as low as minutes, hours, to days, to weeks, some case months. This is a device that runs on the edge, so you can have it on site. You don't require the internet to do its processing. It doesn't have to send to the cloud. It can actually process alerts and everything locally. Really popular for customers that have cell modems and want to limit the amount of traffic that's being sent out. If you're paying by that volume, it can be very helpful to have something that can run all those analytics locally. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen with you.
And while you're doing that, I'll do quick introductions here. So Steve Lee is our technical lead. For many of you, you've already met him, and he's a great guide to help explain our technical aspects of our product. We have Ron Grubbs here as well, who heads up our partnerships and sales. And myself, I'm Andrew Fry. I'm the marketing focal point.
Okay, our URL, home.camect.com. That will get you to a web page. From there, if you've got a Camect that's on the network that you're on, when you type in home.camect.com, we have an option to say, I want to set up a hub. It'll go out and find it, and now you're off and running. The email address that's used to initially set up the hub, we refer to that as the owner account. And that owner account can set up multiple users. You can see I've got three different hubs that I've set up here. I'm going to click on the one in the middle called Doug's House. I've got three cameras that are set up. A couple of things that I'm showing here is that I have a Nest Cam and a Wyze Cam, I think a Hikvision Cam. But different cameras, it doesn't have to be the same type of camera. Camect supports anything that's on Viv. If it basically has a web server and an IP address, we support that. RTSP feeds, we support. As far as cloud-based cameras, Nest, Arlo, and Wyze, we also support those. So this is our hub page. Once I click on it see the cameras that I've added. I'll get into how we add cameras, but I have a couple of icons up here. The first one is the bell icon. Now, we've already set this up to receive alerts, but I kind of want to go sequentially in order, so I'm just going to show you what the icons do, and then we'll sort of explain how we got there. First thing is the bell icon. When I do that, this is almost like having your own monitoring service. It's going to show you the history of what alerts on what day. You quickly can review. If I said I wanted to look on Halloween and I wanted to go through and review alerts, I can see where the event was, who the person was. See, there's a person over here in the corner. We've got somebody coming down the stairs. I can add filters to those. So if I want, I can say, you know, I'm only looking for anything that might have to do with a living room camera. And then it's going to filter it out. So I'm only seeing things from that camera. You can see one of the items that I have set up to look for is a deer. So this thing saw a deer on that day. So this is one quick way to go through and monitor alerts. It's not the only way, but it's a quick way to be able to see the history of your alerts, in a sort of a real user-friendly experience. The gear icon. This is where all the settings are going to take place. You can do all sorts of things here, add devices, create new users, set up your alerts. Let's go through and talk about each one of those. Under the basic tab, and remember, these are the hub settings. So everything that I set up here, with one click of a button, when I go to each camera, I can say, you know what? I've already made all these settings. I'd like that camera to take on those settings. So that's what we're going to do now. First thing is the name of the hub. Then your location. I can choose locations all over the world. Operating mode. We've got a couple operating modes, at home and normal operation. I can toggle between those if I want. I can also set my camera up or my phone to switch back and forth. So if I have them set up at home and I want some cameras to not operate when I'm at home, they'll stop recording at that point. Do I want to back my settings up to the cloud? If I click on that, then I can start saving backups of each of my configurations. So if I wanted to take that configuration and copy it onto another hub, I could do that. Back it up, all the settings, everything that I've done. We have an enable RTSP server. This is for if you're going to do like Immix or third-party monitoring companies that are going to utilize your camera feeds, you want to enable the RTSP server. We also have URLs that we create. Just like you would in an NVR, we're also an NVR, and we create RTSP URLs here for each one of our cameras. So you would just simply copy it. Where it says camect.local, you'd put in your WAN address, and then you would want to make sure port 554 is forwarded. But you actually could have them monitored remotely, even outside of a third-party monitoring company. It works just like any other RTSP feed does. If I click on show advanced settings, I get a few other options. Do I want to scan the network to find other cameras? This by default, you can turn on or off. And then every time you log in, it won't go out and look for new cameras. And periodically it'll do that while you're logged in. Now, let me explain what the purpose of that is. By default, we want the experience to be, I plug it into my home or my business, I've got 10 cameras I want to find. Camect's going to go out and find those cameras. And but maybe you've got some that are on your work desk. You don't want it to find them. It found it the first time. You deleted them. It keeps finding it. Once you found the cameras that you want, you can uncheck this box, and we're not going to then keep scanning. Then you can go in and just simply delete those other two cameras. So if you're in the business where you might have 100 employees and everybody has cameras at their desk, might not want to find all of them, and maybe you want to add them manually, which you can do. If you check some of these boxes, like set passwords on new cameras, so when a camera comes up, to be able to set a login for it. Otherwise, we're automatically, when you see a camera and you punch in that first username and password, we're going to say, well, this is the same camera. You've got 5 Hikvision cameras, I see. We're going to apply that if we can and see if we can get into the other cameras. You may want to add other passwords to it instead of having that done automatically. Under devices, we have the ability to record audio from cameras. You can also turn it on and off. Fetching audio is just so if I log in remotely, I can hear it. Record means it's going to be part of the history of all of our recordings. We'll have audio associated with it. You can say you want to keep things, at most for a certain time or as long as space permits. In this case, it's just going to rewrite over it. We do have an add camera option. Now, not all of our users even need to do this because it's pretty good at going out and finding cameras. One other thing is if you've got the Camect hub set up, let's say on the first network that's created coming from your modem or your first router, but you have multiple networks coming downstream from that, Camect can actually associate itself with 15 different networks. So maybe you've got Camect's plugged into a 192.168.1.1 network, but you've got routers plugged into that network that have their own. It can actually go through and spider those networks and find the cameras automatically. In the event you want to add them, it's a simple click. Then you've got choose your type. Stream URL is if you're going to use the RTSP feed that comes off of your Camect your NVR. Most NVRs and network cameras will have an RTSP feed or substream. If you've got 4K cameras or 8K cameras, Camect has a 24 megapixel on particular models that we're selling now as our sort of goal of trying not to go over that. Because if all of those cameras are seeing high traffic, that's about the point where we're going to say, all right, that's enough processing. You might be able to get away with more if they're not seeing a lot of traffic, but we don't need anywhere near that to be able to process. So we would suggest in cases like that, the NVR maybe that your large resolution cameras have, leave it connected to it, record at whatever resolution you want. But for us, a simple substream at a lower resolution is perfectly fine. We also have different camera, and these are not just manufacturers, but kind of categories. Like an example would be Foscam. Foscam makes cameras for a bunch of people. So we don't list every possible camera that Foscam OEMs cameras for, as well as Hikvision and Amcrest. But we're giving you sort of an idea of these are various manufacturers slash categories of cameras that we support. It by any means is not a limit to the amount of cameras that we support. But you do see there's some cloud-based cameras and YouTube Live, you can actually set that up so we can do the processing through that. You would just simply type in the URL here. If it's just an IP address, you can put that in. If you embed the username and password into it, like it shows here in the example, then it won't ask you for it. But if you just put in the IP, it'll pop up and say, all right, what's your username and password? Once you do it, we're going to remember it. These video feeds are all kept local. It doesn't go to our cloud for processing. We don't have access to them. Unless you share them with our engineering, then we can only see the clip that you shared. Users. So here, the owner account is set up here, it's highlighted in green. If I set anybody else up and I'm an installer, I've set this up at the owner, I go to their house and I give them admin privileges, which can be edited simply to add a user. I would just click a box here. I would type in their email address and then I can go and edit the box of what I want them to have capability of doing. By default, it just lets you view. But if I want to add capability, I could say, you know, make them an admin. As soon as I do that, though, if you have a pro hub, which for anybody that is a professional installer, it does add some extra features. And the hub that I'm going through here today is a pro hub. I'll explain some of those extra features that you get, mostly for monitoring, doing third-party monitoring, doing the setup for that. But if I've set them up as an administrator, then the owner account after 1 hour is going, it's going to truncate my capabilities to have access. Doesn't mean I'll completely lose access, but for camera, be able to watch cameras and stuff like that, I'm going to lose that capability. And it hands over now to the owner. It's by design. So they know and have peace of mind that you're not still logged in as somebody who can see all of their cameras. They can give you capability though. So if I go back here, they can say, you know what, it expired whenever. I want to go and extend that time. If you're working on the system, a simple email to them saying, can you go in to the hub, click under user, and then under the owner account, can you change it to next Tuesday? And then you go in and you can work on it. But they're giving you then the authorization to do it at that point. Other accounts can be set up with other types of capability. Also, we do authentication. You'll see the little icons here. We have Amazon, Apple, regular email, Google. We use that for the initial authentication to verify that it's you. Those different providers have usually your phone number or something, so they'll send you a message and then you have to say, yeah, that's me. You can do it by email as well. But you're going to have that extra step of having to go in, see the email that came in, and then go click on it and then authenticate. So admittedly, it is smoother if you use one of the Google, Amazon, Apple, use one of those as your authenticator. We're not sharing information with them. We're only using it for the security aspect of it because it already has the authenticator built in. And arguably, a lot of people already have those type of email addresses. So we just leverage that capability that's already there. Okay, now under alerts, and this is probably one of the most important sections, is what is it I want to see? So if, as you can see right here, it doesn't look like there's a lot of options. It's like, wow, I would have thought there would have been more. Well, what happens when I say I want to detect alerts? Now it opens up everything. So under detect alerts, I can add time constraints to that. I can say, look, I want to put a hard shutdown to either allow or disallow during time ranges. And I can set that. I can do it based on a calendar. So I can say, well, for the month of, like in my case, I have a camera that's on the front yard. But for Halloween, I had a giant inflatable dragon. And it happens every year. It's setting off the cameras. And I don't want to have to go and do the remasking. And I have other cameras that shoot also the front yard that aren't getting the dragon's wings opening and closing. So I have for the month of October, I just have it set to shut those things off. But I can also add a regular constraint based on a daily basis, a weekdays, weekends, or specific days. So if it's something that's going to be reoccurring, you don't have to pick then from this time to this time. Just put in the simple constraint and it'll sort of take care of itself every day. Send alerts by email, Telegram, or by apps. If this isn't checked, you're going to be receiving alerts and detecting them. It's just not going to send anywhere. So this is something that you want to make sure that the box is checked. You also can put time constraints on that. You can say, well, I do want to get those emails and alerts that come in, but I don't have a do not disturb set up on my phone. So I don't want them coming in after 10 o'clock. I go in and add a constraint and just say, let's just set a constraint from 10 o'clock to 8 in the morning or something like that. And let's do it daily. Hit the check mark. Now that constraint is added. Play voice alerts. So if you have a Chromecast device, you have like Google Home or something connected to the audio output of the Camect Hub. We've got a little mini jack on there that can go into an amplifier that could then broadcast out. Hey, it's going to say our standard alert of, front door camera detected a person, or in my aunt's case, which is one of the cameras that I'm monitoring, or a couple of them, I have it looking for bears and deer and stuff like that. So I have a little Google Home that's at her front door, as well as a light bulb that I have through other means changing color based on when was the last time it saw a bear. So it's she's not afraid of the bears, but it's a notification to let her know that, hey, there's a bear out there. And you can see here by that, I'm detecting for bears, dogs, and people. I can also add other objects. So if I go down here, you can see all the different things that we can do. And you might look and say, well, okay, squirrel, I'm not sure that I need to know about squirrels, but you might want to have those excluded from motion events. So that's probably the bigger reason for some of the things that we have, from spiders and flies and raccoons and those type of things, is maybe you don't want to be alerted when those things happen, and you can do that as well. We have a loitering option. This is a pro feature. And you can set the time limits on how long does somebody have to be loitering in a frame before it's going to send you an alert. Now, this is a feature that kind of annoys my wife, but we have our neighbor who comes over from across the street to play fetch with his dog. And we're good friends, but it annoys us a little bit at night. We're watching TV and the we might be getting alerts on it. So I added the loitering feature. So he's got to be standing out there in frame then for, you know, at least 2 minutes instead of, you know, just a, maybe a standard 2 seconds. Do I want to get alerts whenever new objects are detected? So like, hey, this is something new I haven't seen before. And if it comes in, then I have the option to rate it. And when we get into the individual camera control that I'm showing you, I'll show you why that feature might be helpful. Because maybe you're not sure. You know, I don't know all the things that Camect does. By default, there's going to be a bunch of stuff that we're going to automatically look for. And I've streamlined this list down a little bit. I can give you an example of what it would look like. If I just delete all of these and say I want to detect objects, and then I hit save, and then I go back in, we're going to say, well, you said you wanted to detect objects, and you had nothing checked. So we're going to give you our sample list of what we want to see, what we think you might want to see. So this is what happens with every default Camect. It's going to start looking for these right away. What it does is it creates an experience where we automatically find the cameras. You just simply put in your password, and you're receiving alerts, and it's happening right away. So for most people, this is a pretty flawless experience. Other than maybe, well, I live right outside a DHL hub, and I don't want to see those trucks and alerts going by every time. And just simply uncheck it. So this is where you can customize it. You can go through and delete all of these and put in just what you want. Then auto suppression. So, and also here, just below this, disable the object box. So by default, we are going to create an object box around an event where somebody walked through the frame and you might not even have seen it, but we saw it. And we're going to put a box around to say, here's where to look. And that helps if you're trying to quickly look and see, I don't even see what it was, which you may have experienced before. We'll put an object box around it, but you can disable that if you choose. Now, auto suppression. By default, we are going to suppress alerts that are the same thing happening over and over again. An example might be your neighbor who is mowing his lawn, but your camera happens to pick up his lawn also, or your lawn's being mowed, or something that's happening repeatedly. We're going to start to auto suppress those. And this is an option for you to say, I don't want that. Now, that doesn't mean we're not recording them as alerts. We're just not sending them out, to go out as email alerts or alerts through an app. And down here, these are monitoring company options. We have Dice, Emix, Manitou, Mass, Sentinel, Stages. And we're always working on other ones. If there's market share and we see some demand for it, we've added these over the last couple of years. Long distance mode. Now, we do pretty good out of the box to be able to detect objects. There's videos showing driving rain and somebody walking way in the distance, and it's picking it up as a person without having this enable long distance mode turned on. With that, it's going to look at the frame. And if we can identify through our algorithm that that's a person based on its cadence and the way it's walking or whatever we determine it to be, and you've got that checked as an alert, that type of thing, we're going to be able to find it. Downside is it might go way outside your area of concern. And if by doing long distance mode, you're now picking up the road that's way off in the distance where normally it wouldn't have giving you alerts for cars going by, well, now it's something that you're going to see. And then send alerts for cameras that are offline, and you can set a time limit on those. This space, we've got an internal disk. It's about a one terabyte, and it records continuously. I can add other drives, though. I can add network drives. Maybe I have a Synology drive that I want to record everything to. I can set all that up here, different formats. Also, there is a USB 3.0. You can plug a USB drive in on the side, and it will automatically pop up and show here as another drive.
Hey, Steve, we had a question come in that, actually a couple of them, but does auto suppressed only last for a time window?
No, once you have that box checked or unchecked, it's going to keep it in that that format until you either you go back in and change it. So it when you check it, it's not like it's, you know, it only auto suppresses for an hour. If you say, look, don't auto suppress, then we're not going to. And then, as long as that box is checked and it stays checked.
And the other one was, do we have a certified list of cameras tested with Camect?
We do have on our Learning More page, we have a camera section that has, you know, our little write-up about a bunch of cameras. And, it, you know, like an example will be like Arlo. Yes, we work with Arlo, but, you know, keep in mind, with an Arlo camera that's battery powered, we want to keep connected to that stream coming off of that camera, that local stream. And that's going to run that battery down quicker than if you let Arlo just send out video alerts whenever it sees something. So you're going to want to, you know, try to permanently power those up if you want them to not be changing batteries every few days. But yeah, we do have that in our Learning More guide. There's a camera section that goes through different cameras and talks about them. Arguably, we probably haven't listed every possible camera that's out there. It's more of a narrative of most cameras that are discoverable. If you're familiar with VLC, you know, if you can put a camera into VLC and see it, we can see it. Anything that can be used through that video player. And now the Me tab. So the Me tab is for the hub settings. I can simply go in here and I can say, you know, I want to snooze alerts. I want to take a nap. It's the middle of the day. I want to snooze alerts for an hour or 3 hours. Any camera that I have set up that is using the hub settings, by the fact that I went in here under the Me tab in the hub settings, all those cameras will be snoozed. Send alerts by email. I can choose what I want. Do I want the name of the camera to come in? Some people are saying, well, I've got multiple alerts that are coming in from multiple hubs. I'd like to know in the video, I'd like to know what hub it's coming from, you know, because I have four different places I monitor and three of them have Front Door as the name of one of their cameras. So what you can do is for the home name, when you name your system, then you can put the address as the home name. You can put something that's meaningful. So now in your camera alert that comes in, you're going to get the name of the hub. You'll get the camera name. You can get a date, a time, and if you want, what object was detected. All of that can be put into the email. And also, once again, time constraints. And do I want to send emails if my home is offline or online? I can set that up to do that as well. So those are our hub settings. Once you've gone through and done all of that, there aren't any more settings that you have to do. In other words, I can now go in to the backyard camera here, and under alerts, I can just say, hey, you know what? Use home hub settings. I've already set it all up. But if I want this camera in particular to act different than any of my other cameras, I uncheck hub, and then I can go through and micromanage how I want it to look and what it's looking for. But you'll notice that most of these settings are exactly the same that you would have had on the hub setting. So if I uncheck here, use hub settings for video and audio, it lets me alter these. Otherwise, it grays them out. Alerts is no different. If I say use this, it's all grayed out and there's nothing that I can edit here. Except down at the bottom, I can create a new rating. I'm going to show you a couple of ways to do this. This is where you would mask out a camera view. So if I said, I want to create a new rating, and by default, it says, I want to see fewer things like this. Make sure that you notice this. And if you click on that thumbs down, it changes to a thumbs up and it says, I want to see alerts that involve what? Well, I'm looking, let's say specifically for my dog, that occur in a certain area. Now, I've just got started on this, but this is a tiki bar that I'm building out back. And these are sliding barn doors and a thatched roof and all of that. But my dog's been going in there. He goes in there for about a minute and then he comes out, and he might be sitting on the couch in there. But I can click and say, you know what? I want to look just in that area, and I'm looking for dogs. Because otherwise he's out in the backyard all the time running around when he's not in the house. So there's my alert. And then I can put time constraints or anything like that that I want to it. And then just go down and hit save. So now I've got one set up for that area in the camera. If I go back in and let's say something happens, I'm going to play an alert. It puts a box on here. It shows me where the alert is. There's my, caught my dog in the corner, and let's see if he goes in there. It's thinking about it. Anyhow, if that's, I'm like, yep, that's it. That's what I want. Boom. I can click the thumbs up and rate that alert right then. And it already knows that it wants to see a dog because that's what it saw. And then do I care about time constraints to say, well, look, I don't care at night, you know, but during the day, I don't want them going in there, whatever it is. And around the same area in the image, because we've already figured out where it found the dog based on the bounding box. And I can say, yeah, that was perfectly fine. Just use that same box. I don't want to see any other alerts for other objects. You know, I can do that as well. I'm only looking for that area for a dog. It's another way to create it without having to manually create the bounding box. And then I can go through and hit save. I'll be able to have, if I go into my wrench there, I'll go down and I'm going to have that alert, and I can edit the bounding box and, you know, do that if I want. So I just want to share with you that this is how you can help it learn even more by really defining specific areas at specific times for certain events. Disk space, it's identical. Sync. I don't think I talked about sync on the last one, but I'll do it here. Sync is where, if you want alerts to be shared with us or synced up, you can share them to a third-party storage. So if I say, yeah, I want to create a new thing, I can go to Google Drive if I want. I can share them to YouTube. And that way, if you see something that was maybe miscategorized or you think it was, then you can share it with us and we'll go through and fix that algorithm or add to it. And you won't see it again. I mean, we'll usually get it fixed pretty quick. And we've been doing that so long now that it doesn't happen very often that there's something that we miss or we miscategorize it. Now, occasionally, if you're not sure what it is and it looks like a cat, and then we're going to identify it pretty quick. And then once it gets into the light and it turns sideways, you realize, oh, it's a raccoon. It may see it as a raccoon then also. But initially, we don't want to have to wait, you know, 10 seconds to say, oh, well, we're, you know, it looked like from the clip that we saw. So keep that in mind, that unless there's enough information for us to determine what it is based on how it's walking or its, you know, the format that we see, it may take until it turns before we actually get it correct. But we did identify it as either an unknown animal or a cat. And arguably, most people might look at that video clip and go, yeah, that looked like a cat until it turned sideways. So just keep that in mind. Some of those things won't be able to resolve because even a human thought it was a cat initially. But we don't want to wait and, like I said, review 30 seconds of footage before we go, oh, okay, yeah, well, that was a raccoon. We're not going to send out anything until we absolutely have seen all different sides of it. So we, but arguably I've had it running in my house for over a year and it doesn't miss. It's really good at not sending me false alerts and sending me what I want to see. Under the Me tab, here I can just say, you know what, use the hub setting. So it gives me no options to do anything for this particular camera. If I uncheck it, then I can just snooze this camera if I want for a period of time. So having that, it's all grayed out. Unchecking it says only for this camera do I want to snooze for an hour or something like that.
Steve, all right. We had one, I'm sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
We had one come in. It says clarify recording specific or all alert types versus sending specific alerts via email.
Okay, let me go back in there. Was that something I said or was it a box that you saw? I want to make sure I'm commenting on the right thing.
I'm not sure. It says clarify if you're recording for specific or all type alert types and then versus sending of specific alerts via email.
Okay. So here, detect object alerts. I could choose everything that we have and we're going to get alerts for all of those. So send alerts, even if no objects are detected, like trees moving and all of that. This is something that you're going to find, if you check that box, you're going to find that that's your experience with a lot of cameras or systems that are detecting objects, that a tree moving in the background might also be perceived as that. If you do that, you're going to get any motion. So if it's super critical where it's not in our category of devices that you're going to see, you can check this box. Let me see what else here. The box of send alerts whenever a new object is detected, that's going to be, I want an alert if anything new is that I haven't seen before, because I might want to add it to my list of things that I'm looking at receiving. Let me click away. Okay. Do you see the cabin now or not?
Yeah, we see that now.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So let me play this. I'll play this alert. So this alert came in, tells me what it is. It's a deer. And if I said, you know what? Yeah, these are all the things I'm recording. Then you can just go, yeah, thumbs down on that. We're still going to save it as an alert. We save useful alerts, uninteresting alerts, and suppressed alerts where the deer have been walking around back there. We're going to put a little search option for them so you can search them, but they're just listed in a different category and they're not being sent to your phone. So I think that answers your question. Yeah, I never got the alert from Telegram. I just wanted to show you quickly here. If you click on your icon in the upper right-hand corner, this is where service plans and different things that you can update, signing in, signing out. But if you want to receive alerts in Telegram, you could click here and then choose that option. And then you can say, all right, it's going to send a message. And if you've downloaded the Telegram app, it's going to give you a tab to say start and you're receiving alerts. We've done a video on that, on how to set up Telegram that we can share if anybody would like to see that at some point. And finally, let me go through here now and show you reviewing the timeline. So the bell icon will have a green ring around or a highlight if there are alerts that haven't been viewed. Right now it says, hey, there's 39 new alerts, 39 alerts and 38 of them are new. So these haven't been viewed in a while. The camera in the upper left-hand corner is a camera in Southern California. The other two cameras are cameras in Duluth, Minnesota. So you can monitor cameras from all over. All you need is just access to them, and you can add them into Camect. So here, I click on the hub. You see it saw a deer. If I went down here and said, I want to click on the negative side or the positive side, see how I'm zooming in down here? Let me go full screen so you can see it better. I'm going to click on the magnifying glass, and now I'm at 1 week, 3 days, 1 day, 12 hours, 3 hours. And see the hashes down here? It's hard to see, but there's color coding that it's associated with those, whether they're interesting alerts or uninteresting. So if I click on here, here's an event, and it's going to go through and play back what it was. Now, I might have to wait till it actually happens because it crops out a window of time. But in those events, something that was in my list of things it wanted to see, it found. And so it's just a quick way for you to be able to go, okay, it's roughly right about this area. Now I can drill down on it even more and say, okay, 30 minutes, 10 minutes. So within that, this said, all right, there was activity within this whole window of time. I can fast forward through it if I want. And to get back to live view, I can simply click here and I'm in the live view of the camera. If I found an alert that I like, here's a deer, you know what? I want to share that with somebody. I can simply go right here, click on share. Do I want to do full length or do I want to summarize it? And do I want to send it somewhere to one of my drives? And I can share that video. I also can crop it out myself. So if I went and said, you know, let me go back here to the beginning of it, I can put a bracket on that and say, I'm only looking and I'm watching it until he looks in directly into the camera, and I bracket it. See that little short, the green and the blue brackets that are on the left there? I can download it. If I have to give this to the police, I can download the clip. I can view just that clip that's in brackets. I can also share it, that clip. And I've done a 5-second video by putting my own brackets on it. Otherwise, it will say, well, here's the whole event in itself. The deer hung out for a while. It went on for 3 minutes. You know, do you want all of it or do you want to crop it down yourself? Also, I can click up here when I'm playing an event, and I can choose to have it paint the paintbrush on or off around the event. Maybe it's distracting, you don't want to see it. I can change the speed also. So here I can say, let's go 16 times and I can get through it much quicker. Okay, even though he was just hanging out there for a while, now I can zoom through that event. And that's kind of the nuts and bolts of Camect and how we go through and can monitor alerts, receive alerts, you know, set them up, get the hub initially plugged in. Once you plug it in, we see it on the network, and you give it a name and create a owner account for it. You can add multiple users and give them multiple capabilities to, you know, what they can do with the hub. There's some people who only need access just to receive alerts. They don't need to do any other stuff, and you totally have that capability. Anything else that, any questions I missed or anything that you don't think was covered? I'll go over IMIX. Okay. And also, if you already have a Camect or you're thinking about getting one, if you go to home.camect.com/v2, this is our new interface that we're working on. the slash V2. A lot of the same similar features. Not everything is supported yet, but just a we've added some things within here. Like if you just want to take a picture right away of maybe what it sees in the event. But let me go back here and we'll go into MX. I also have video that is on our YouTube channel going through the whole MX setup. But I'm going to go into settings for the hub. I'm going to go into alerts. I'll scroll down here. I go to MX and I've already got some settings in here, but let's say I hadn't, it would look like this. You say, okay, your device ID. Well, your device ID is found when you go into MX, into your account, and you add a new account that you're monitoring. And once you get all the way to the end, you get a summary page, and it gives you your device ID. And let's say it's 1007, your SMPT server. This is your URL. So let's say it's 56.23.145.245.12. Username and password. This would be the local login for your Camect Hub. Password is the prefix used on the owner account. Let's say if it was steve@camect.com, password is Steve. When you're accessing directly by IP address, normally you don't have to do that. If you do want to have alerts that are auto-suppressed, you want them to be sent also. Then you can add a camera and say, all right, I want to do the cabin camera. MX can automatically pull these in. So it's going to automatically define it in the MX side of it to say, oh, okay, well, your cabin camera was camera one. So I'm just going to say it's one and then say, okay, now I have a camera here. And then I can test it. And if it was all set up correctly, it would run through and say, oh, hey, the test worked correctly. I made all this information up, so it's not going to work. But that's all it takes on our end. Here's one where I've set it up and tested it, and indeed it tested successfully. And it sent a sample alert. But to see both sides of it, the full MX software UI, and that we do have a video on our YouTube channel that I did that goes through step by step all of that. Anything else? Hopefully this was helpful. We can do more events like this that can be tailored to specific things. If we get feedback that, hey, it'd be great if we could spend a half hour just on this one thing, or, you know, we're happy to do that.
Yeah, so please stay tuned to our LinkedIn page for updates, and we're likely going to have a more of a deep dive into MX and other topics that we'll be sharing in the future. And also, please feel free to reach out to us if you have other ideas or topics that you'd recommend that we share. So thanks a lot for attending, folks.
And we did record this. So obviously I went through a bunch of stuff so I could get as much done in our hour limit. And we can make that recording available so you can review it if you want.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks. Cheers.
All right. Take care.